my divine forms, but only of those which are prominent or best of gurus, for there is no end to my extent, the details. So Shri Krishna begins this word, verse with the word hanta. In Sanskrit, the word hanta is counted as an avyay, undeclinable word. Avyay, undeclinable words cannot be changed with tense, place or time. Hanta, undefinable, is such a word, and can have many meanings. Srimad Adishankaracharya defines the word hanta as now, idanim. The word hanta is descriptive of bliss and also descriptive of interest. When someone gets some extremely important news, then we can find the word hanta used on many such occasions. But here the word hanta is not born of interest, as it normally is, but it is born of bliss. This is the word hanta. The Supreme Soul's bliss becomes apparent in two ways. The first is that the Supreme Soul is showing his acceptance of Arjuna's request by using the word hanta. Arjuna asks the Lord to describe his divine manifestations, and this shows acceptance of that request. Secondly, the Lord has bliss because Arjuna is asking to find out about these great things, and this bliss becomes apparent with the use of the word hanta. This is because from the questions that the people ask the guru sometimes get this, that my pupil is asking such beautiful questions. Because he's asking such beautiful questions, this means that he's thinking in this direction. The guru gets bliss out of this. This is the word hanta, meaning now. Shri Krishna addresses Arjuna as Guru Shrestha, meaning best of the gurus. The Lord tells Arjuna that he will declare to Arjuna of his divine manifestations, but only of those which are permanent, because there is no end to the greatness of the Supreme Soul. The Lord describes his manifestations as Divya, divine. What does Divya mean? Divya, divine, is a perspective. The Lord is going to talk about these later in the 11th chapter. We have two words, Laukik, worldly, and Alaukik, unworldly. There is Divya, divine, and everyday business. What does Divya mean? Whenever you see something special in the material world, and any specialness that there is in the material world, is that of Lord. Whenever you see the Lord in that specialness, then this is Divyata, divinity. Secondly, any specialness that is there, the thinking that it is objects, people, or events is Laukika, worldness. This is everyday business. If you see a nice flower, then you see a specialness in that flower. You see that this flower has something special that you do not see in other flowers. When you feel like this and feel that specialness, then upon seeing that specialness, who do you immediately remember? If you feel that this specialness is out of the Supreme Soul, then this is a Divya, divine perspective. And if you think that this specialness is of the flower, then that becomes the specialness of the object. If you feel the specialness of gardener, a person, or the event, a circumstance, then these are Laukik, worldly perspectives. These are everyday business perspectives. The manifestation of himself that the Lord is describing here have the qualification of being Divya, divine. The Lord is saying that these manifestations of his are Divya, divine, and this means that when seeing these manifestations, one should remember the Supreme Soul. Before the Lord himself began describing his own manifestations, he says very clearly that he is describing these manifestations because whenever your eyes fall on them in this material world, then you should remember him. If something is beautiful in the world, then you know how to look at beautiful things. But do you remember the Lord when seeing his beauty? Do you remember God? If we do, then we are seeing the Lord's divine manifestations. If we remember objects while seeing beauty, then this is a Laukik, worldly perspective. With this brief introduction, we will enter into the Supreme Soul's divine descriptions. Shri Krishna also uses the word Atma Vibhutara, meaning my manifestations. What does Vibhuti mean? There are two words in Sanskrit. The first is Bhuti, and the second is Vibhuti. Bhuti means to happen, or that which is born. Vibhuti means Visheshena Bhuti. The Lord is in each and every atom as Bhuti, that which is born. Shri Ram is in each and every atom. He is that. Shri Ram is omnipresent and has Bhuti, that which is born. Whether we can see it or not, whether we can know that or not, Bhuti, that which is born, is there. But to be born in a particular form is Vibhuti, a manifestation. The Supreme Soul is omnipresent in the form of Bhuti, that which is born, but in the form of Vibhuti manifestation, the Supreme Soul is in very few places. If I were to say in simple language, the Vibhuti manifestation is that that object, that person, or that event reaches its ultimate peak, and the truth of the Supreme Soul begins to become manifest. This is when a person, an object, or an event reaches their peak state. This is because every object, every person, and every event is a potentiality. There are possibilities residing in it. There are many possibilities and probabilities residing in it. When these possibilities and probabilities are open to their complete form, then there is a quote that I like very much, and I quote it over and over again. What science calls a seed, Homer calls a flower. Science only calls a seed, but Homer says no, this is a flower. The perspective of science is limited to the present and what the senses see. The senses may see that something is a seed, whereas Homer is a search for possibilities. And not only that, it is the quest for the potentialities. We put Homer within a lot of limited boundaries. We say that Homer is going to a few temples, eating prasad oblations, or doing arati, a form of worship, in which light from wicks, soap and ghee, purified butter or camphor is offered to one or more deities. All of this is necessary, and this is not a denial of this, but if you want to defy Homer in its reality, then Homer is a quest for potentialities. Homer asks about what this person can become. Homer has no interest in turning cycles over and over again. Homer has interest in only one thing, to reach you to your ultimate peak. Each and every person has been created to do something. First of all, you should search for what you are created to become. And when you reach the ultimate peak of this, then consider that you are dharmic. No person was created to do wrong things. This is a principle of the world. The person may have made a mistake or have fallen over, but no person has been created in this world in order to become angry. No person has been created in this world in order to become greedy. No person has been created in this world in order to become a rogue. This is not potentiality, but it is possible that a person may not have recognized the true power inside himself, and that is why he walked on the wrong path. The power is there, but he used that strength on the wrong path. If I were to say it using a simple example, then I can say that the tank of a car is filled with petrol, and this petrol has power. You can either use that power to go to a good place or to a bad place. You have the power to make a decision. The steering wheel is in the hands of the person. In the same way, the steering wheel in our lives is in our hands. Udre dātma ātmanam dātmanam ava sadeya. Dharma says only one thing. The power of the supreme truth is residing in you, and you should take it to the right direction. Whenever you see something special, the former habit of seeing the supreme soul there. Wherever you see something special, if there are a lot of people sitting at a hall during a Dharma discourse, then you see something special in there. You see beauty in the person in a way that you do not see in other people. If you do, then worship the supreme soul in that beauty. If you see wisdom in the person that you do not have seen before, then worship the supreme soul in that knowledge. If you see a beautiful skill in the person that you have not seen before, then worship the supreme soul in that beautiful skill. If a piece of work is given to all of us, then every person perform the work in their own way. But if one person has such beautiful skill in performing that work, that she turns that work into an art, then see the supreme soul in that beautiful skill. This is called Vibhuti Darshan, seeing the Lord's manifestations. Shri Krishna uses the word Pradhan Yadaha to describe what he is going to say in forthcoming verses to show Arjun what he is going to talk about his most prominent forms, and that they are just a few examples, because there is no extent to the extent of the greatness of the Lord. How can the Lord describe each and every one of his attributes, and it is not possible for him to do so? This is because it is not as if one Vibhuti Divine Manifestation stays the same. Vibhuti Divine Manifestations keep happening. They are continuously happening. The Lord described all these Vibhuti Divine Manifestations to Arjun 5,000 years ago, but if God came in front of us today and we asked God to describe his Vibhuti Divine Manifestations, then God may talk about 200 or 500 Vibhuti Divine Manifestations, and yet God will say that there is no end to his Vibhuti Divine Manifestations. And the Lord will say this very thing in the last verse of this 10th chapter. Ekanshi Nashito Jarat, I support the entire universe, pervading it with a single fraction of myself. How then can we recognize the Lord's Vibhuti Divine Manifestations? The Vibhuti Divine Manifestations that the Lord is going to describe have three qualities. First of all, they are where there is a special Aishwarya, wealth. Aishwarya means wealth, but not wealth in terms of rupees or paisas, but where there is a special wealth. Secondly, they are where there is a special Shobha, glory. It often happens that there is Aishwarya, wealth, but not Shobha, glory. Thirdly, they are where there is a special Prabhav, effectivity. Four people can say the same thing, but all four of those people can have a different Prabhav, effectivity. To be a Vibhuti Divine Manifestation, there needs to be a Prabhav, effectivity. If there are four elders in a house, then they may tell the child not to eat chocolates. The father will say this, the mother will say this, the uncle will say this, and the older brother can also say this. But each of these four people can have a different effect on the mind of the child. In the same way, this effectivity is the bath. We often say in families that whenever the father asks, then the child always listens, but when the mother says, then the child will not listen. The meaning of this is that the effectiveness of the mother, in this case, is less. This is the importance of the bath, effectivity. Wherever there is a special Aishwarya, wealth, a special Shubha, glory, and a special Abhav, effectivity, and understand that the Vibhuti Divine Manifestation of the Supreme Soul is there. These are the qualifications. We're going to take these three measuring sticks and we'll look at what God is going to say in the forthcoming verses. These three things will continuously keep coming in the Vibhuti divine manifestations that the Lord will show us. A special Aishwarya wealth, a special Shobha Dori, and a special Prabhav effectivity. Let us go to the next verse.